Recorded books and one-click digital present Make Something Up, Stories You Can't Unread, by Chuck Palahniuk. Narrated by Ken Marks, Luis Moreno, Rich Orlow, T. Ryder Smith, Scott Sowers, and the author.
This is Knock Knock, narrated by Chuck Palahniuk. My old man, he makes everything into a big joke. What can I say? The old man loves to get a laugh. Growing up, half the time, I didn't have a clue what his jokes were about, but I laughed anyways. Down at the barber shop, it didn't matter how many guys my father let take cuts ahead of him in line. He just wanted to sit there all Saturday and crack people up, make folks bust a gut. Getting his hair cut was definitely a low priority. He says, "Stop me if you've heard this one before." The way my old man tells it, he walks into the oncologist's office and he says, "After the chemotherapy, will I be able to play the violin?" In response, the oncologist says, "It's metastasized. You've got 6 months to live." And working his eyebrows like Groucho Marx, tapping the ash from an invisible cigar, my old man says, "6 months?" He says, "I want a second opinion." So the oncologist, he says, "Okay, you've got cancer and your jokes stink." So they do the chemotherapy and they give him some radiation like they do. Even if the shit burns him up so bad on the inside, he tells me that taking a piss is like passing razor blades. He's still every Saturday down by that barber shop, telling jokes even if now he's bald as a cue ball. I mean, he's skinny as a bald skeleton, and he's getting to haul around one of those cylinders of oxygen under pressure, like some little version of a ball and chain. He walks into the barber shop, dragging that pressurized cylinder of oxygen with the tube of it going up and looping around his nose and over his ears and around his bald head, and he says, "Just a little off the top, please." And folks laugh. Understand me. My old man is no Uncle Milty. He's no Edgar Bergen. The man's skinny as a Halloween skeleton and bald and gonna be dead by 6 weeks. So it don't matter what he says. Folks are gonna hee-haw like donkeys just out of their genuine affection for him. But seriously, I'm not doing him justice. It's my fault if this doesn't come across, but my old man is funnier than he sounds. Maybe his sense of humor is a talent I didn't inherit. Back when I was his little Charlie McCarthy, the whole time growing up, he used to ask me, "Knock, knock." And I'd say, "Who's there?" And he'd say, "Old lady." And I'd say, "Old lady who?" And he'd say, "Wow, I didn't know you could yodel." Me, I didn't get it. I was so stupid. I was 7 years old and still stuck in the first grade. I didn't know Switzerland from Shinola. But I want for my old man to love me. So I learned to laugh. Whatever he says, I laugh. By old lady, my guess is he means my mom, who ran away and left us. All my old man will say about her is how she was a real looker who just couldn't take a joke. She just was not a good sport. He used to ask me, "When that Vinnie Van Gogh cut off his ear and sent it to that whore he was so crazy about, how'd he send it?" The punchline is, he sent it by ear mail. But being 7 years old, I was still stuck back on not knowing who Van Gogh is or what's a whore. And nothing kills a joke faster than asking my old man to explain himself. So when my old man says, "What do you get when you cross a pig with Count Dracula?" I knew to never ask, "What's Count Dracula?" I'd just get this big laugh ready for when he tells me, "A hampire." And when he says, "Knock, knock," and I say, "Who's there?" And he says, "Radio." And I say, radio who? And he's already started to bust a gut when he says, radio not, I'm gonna come in your mouth. Well, what the hell? I just keep laughing. My whole growing up, I figure I'm just too ignorant to appreciate a good joke. Me, my teachers, still haven't covered long division and all the multiplication tables. So it's not my old man's fault. I don't know what's come. My old lady who abandoned us, he says that she hated that joke. So maybe I inherited her lack of humor. But love. I mean, you have to love your old man. I mean, after you're born, it's not like you get a choice. Nobody wants to see their old man breathing out of some tank and going into the hospital to die sky high on morphine. And he's not eating a bite of that red-flavored jello they serve for dinner. Stop me if I already told you this one. But my old man gets that prostate cancer that's not even like cancer because it takes 20, 30 years before we even know he's so sick. And the next thing I know is I'm trying to remember all the stuff that he's taught me. Like if you spray WD-40 on the shovel blade before you dig a hole, the digging will go a lot easier. And he taught me how to squeeze a trigger instead of pulling it and wrecking my aim. And he taught me to remove bloodstains. And he taught me jokes. Lots of jokes. And sure, he's no Robin Williams. But I watched this movie one time about Robin Williams, who gets dressed up with a red rubber ball on his nose and this big rainbow-colored afro wig and those big clown shoes with a fake carnation stuck in his buttonhole of his shirt that squirts water. And the guy's a hotshot doctor who makes these little kids with cancer laugh so hard they stop dying. Understand me, these bald kid skeletons who look worse off than my old man, they get healthy, and that whole movie is based on a true story. What I mean is, we all know that laughter is the best medicine. All that time being stuck in the hospital waiting room, even I read the Reader's Digest, and we've all heard that true story about the guy with a brain cancer the size of a grapefruit inside of his skull and he's about to croak. All the doctors and priests and experts say that he's a goner. Only he forces himself to watch nonstop movies about the Three Stooges. This stage 4 cancer guy forces himself to laugh nonstop at Abbott and Costello and Laurel and Hardy and those Marx brothers. And he gets healed by the endorphins and the oxygenated blood. So I figure, what have I got to lose? All I need to do is remember some of my old man's favorite gags and get him started back laughing on the road to recovery. I figure, what could it hurt? So this grown-up son walks into his father's hospice room, pulls up a chair beside the bed, and sits down. The son looks into his old man's pale, dying face, and he says, so this blonde gal walks into a neighborhood bar where she's never been before, and she's got tits out to here and a tight little hiney, and she asks the bartender for a Michelob, and he serves her a Michelob, except he sneaks a Mickey Finn into her bottle, and this blonde goes unconscious, and every guy in the bar leans her over the edge of the pool table and hikes up her skirt and fucks her. And at closing time, they slap her awake and they tell her that she's got to leave. And every few days, this gal with the tits and the ass, she walks in and asks for a Michelob and gets a Mickey Finn and gets fucked by the crowd until one day she walks in and asks the bartender, can he maybe just give her a Budweiser instead? Granted, I have not landed this particular shaggy dog story since I was in the first grade, but my old man used to love this next part. The bartender smiles so nice and says, what, you don't like Michelob no more? And this real looker, she leans over the bar all confidential and she whispers, just between you and me, she whispers, Michelob makes my pussy hurt. The first time I learned that joke, when my old man taught it to me, I didn't know what was pussy. I didn't know Mickey Finn. I didn't know what folks meant when they talked about fucking. But I knew all this talk made my old man laugh. And when he told me to stand up and tell that joke in the barber shop, it made the barbers and every old man reading detective magazines laugh until half of them blew spit and snot and chewing tobacco out their noses. Now, the grown-up son tells his old dying father this joke, just the two of them alone in that hospital room late, late at night. And guess what? His old man doesn't laugh. So the son tries another old favorite. He tells the joke about the traveling salesman who gets a phone call from some farmer's daughter he met on the road a couple months before, and she says, "Remember me? We had some laughs, and I was a good sport." And the salesman, he says, "How you doing?" And she says, "I'm pregnant, and I'm going to kill myself." And the salesman, he says, "Damn, you are a good sport." At 7 years old, I could really put that joke over. But tonight, the old man's still not laughing. How I learned to say I love you was by laughing for my old man, even if I had to fake it. And that's all I want in return. All I want from him is a laugh, just one laugh, and he's not coming across with even a giggle, not a snicker, not even a groan. And worse than not laughing, the old man squints his eyes shut tight and opens them brimming with tears, and one fat tear floods out the bottom of each eye and washes down each cheek. The old man's gasping his big toothless mouth like he can't get enough air, crying big tears down the wrinkles of both cheeks, just soaking his pillow. So, this kid, who's nobody's little kid, not anymore, but who can't seem to forget these jokes, he reaches into his pants pocket and he gets out a fake carnation that, just for laughs, sprays water all over the old crybaby's face. The kid tells about the Polak, who's carrying a rifle through the woods when he comes across a naked gal laying back on a bed of soft green moss with her legs spread. And this gal is a real looker. And she looks at the Polak and his gun and she says, "What are you doing?" And the Polak says, "I'm hunting for game." And this real looker, she gives him a big wink and she says, "I'm game." So, pow, the Polak shoots her. It used to be this joke constituted a gold-plated, bona fide, sure-thing laugh riot. But the old man just keeps dying. He's still crying and not even making an effort to laugh. And no matter what, the old man has got to meet me halfway. I can't save him if he doesn't want to live. I ask him, "What do you get when you cross a faggot with a kike?" I ask him, "What's the difference between dog shit and a nigger?" And he's still not getting any better. I'm thinking maybe the cancer's got into his ears with the morphine and all. It could be that he cannot hear me. So just to test, can he hear me? I lean into his crybaby face and I ask, "How do you get a nun pregnant?" Then more loud, maybe too loud for this being a mackerel snapper hospital, I yell, "You fuck her!" In my desperation, I try fag jokes and wetback jokes and kike jokes. Really, every effective course of treatment known to medical science. And the old man's still slipping away. Laying here, in this bed, is the man who made everything into a big joke. Just the fact that he's not biting scares the shit out of me. I'm yelling, "Knock, knock!" And when he says nothing in response, it's the same as him not having a pulse. I'm yelling, "Knock, knock!" I'm yelling, "Why did the existentialist cross the road?" And he's still dying. The old man's leaving me not knowing the answer to anything. He's abandoning me while I'm still so fucking stupid. In my desperation, I reach out to take the limp blue fingers of his cold, cold, dying hand. And he doesn't flinch, even when I grind a joy buzzer against the blue skin of his ice-cold palm. I'm yelling, knock, knock. I'm yelling, why'd the old lady walk out on her husband and her four-year-old kid? And nothing kills a joke like asking my old man to explain himself, and laying there in that bed, he stops breathing, no heartbeat, totally flatlined. So this kid, who's sitting bedside in his hospital room late, late at night, he takes the joke equivalent of those electric paddles doctors use to stop your heart, the hee-haw equivalent of what a paramedic Robin Williams would use on you, and some clown emergency room, a kind of Three Stooges defibrillator. The kid takes a big, creamy, heaped-up custard pie, topped with a thick, thick layer of whipped cream. And the kid reaches that pie up sky high overhead, as high as the kid can reach, and brings it down hard, lightning fast, slam dunking it as hard as the blast from a Pollock shotgun, pow, right in his old man's kisser. And despite the miraculous, well-documented healing powers of the comedic arts, my old man dies taking a big bloody shit in his bed. No, really, it's funnier than it sounds. Please don't blame my old man. If you're not laughing at this point, it's my fault. I just didn't tell it right. You know, you mess up a punchline and you can totally botch even the best joke. For example, I went back to the barber shop and I told them how he died and how I tried to save him, right up to and including the custard pie and how the hospital had their security goons escort me up to the crazy ward for a little 72-hour observation. And even telling that part, I fucked it up. Because those barbershop guys just looked at me. I told them about seeing and smelling my old man, dead and smeared all over with blood and shit and whipped cream, all that stinking sugar. And they looked and looked at me, the barbers and the old guys chewing tobacco, and nobody laughed. Standing in that same barber shop. All those years later, I say, knock, knock. The barbers stop cutting hair. The old goobers stop chewing on their tobacco. I say, knock, knock. Nobody takes a breath, and it's like I'm standing in a room full of dead men. And I tell them, death. Death is there. Don't you people never read Emily Dickerson? You never heard of John Paul Stewart? I wiggle my eyebrows and I tap the ash from my invisible cigar and say, who's there? I say, I don't know who's there. I can't even play the violin. What I do know is I've got a brain filled with jokes I can't ever forget. Like a tumor the size of a grapefruit inside of my skull. And I know that eventually even dog shit turns white and stops stinking. But I have this permanent head filled with crap I've been trained my whole life to think is funny. And for the first time since I was a little stooge standing in the barbershop saying fag and cunt and nigger and saying kike, I figure out that I wasn't telling a joke. I was the joke. I mean, I finally get it. Understand me. A bona fide gold-plated joke is like a Michelob served ice cold with a Mickey Finn by somebody smiling so nice that you won't never know how bad you've been fucked. And a punchline is called a punchline for a very good reason. Because punchlines are a sugar-coated fist with whipped cream hiding the brass knuckles that socks you right in the kisser, hitting you, pow, right in your face and saying, I am smarter than you, and I am bigger than you, and I call the shots here, buddy boy. And standing in that same old Saturday morning barbershop, I scream, knock, knock. I demand, knock, knock.
And finally, one old barbershop codger, he says, in barely a tobacco whisper, so soft you can hardly hear him, he asks, who's there? And I wait a beat, just for the tension. My old man, he taught me that timing is crucial. Timing is everything. Until finally, I smile so nice, and I say, radio not.
Eleanor, narrated by Chuck Palahniuk. Randy hate trees. He hate trees so passionate that when the internet journalized about the wholesale defenestration of the Amazon rain jungle, Randy, he considered that to be a fine and noble term of events. Mostly pine trees. He hate the way a pine tree move. It moves slow, then move fast. First so excoriating slow, you forget it always be moving. That the method of tree get its tonnage of board feet up higher and higher, until it be zeroed in right on top of person's head. After that, a pine tree move fast, like booby trap fast, too fast to perception. Leastwise, Randy Daddy never perception it coming. Post-dating a lifetime of setting choke and pulling green chain, Randy Daddy already be living on bothered time. One fast move and all that raw lumber smatter the hairy dome of his thin skull to a billion bloody fractions. Randy figure he got better things to do than sit around and maybe get landed on by 100 tons of celluloid fiber. Randy hate Oregon. Randy transpire to live someplace pink stucco where trees don't never enter into the picture. Randy, he pocket the life assurance money and stow his pit bull in his car. He steer south, exacerbating faster and faster the whole way, like if a pack of vapid wolfhounds be perusing his Randy ass. In California, the reality agent point her eyeballs at Randy Ride, a Celica tricked out with twice the blue book worth in aftermarket chrome. And the regent, she take note of Randy Pitbull, such standard confessional rebellions. The regent readily exhume Randy's shaved head, and fresh inked facial taboo be leaking blood still. The regent prop open her laptop and recede to source a pirate download. She tell Randy dog, she say dog, you go be so skinny on this crib. The reality agent, she be named Gazelle. And Gazelle laptop play a movie before Randy prolapsed eyeballs. It be explicit content burn from content, burn from content, burn from content, burn from content, 1,000 generation removed from anything paid good money for. The regent say, dog, she say, dog, this be entitled Run and Hide Little White Girl 4. Said movie be starring Jennifer Jason Morrell. She betray a blonde sneak thief out to brutalize a fly crib where a dozen bro dogs capitulate to respire. The bro dogs be metastasizing in bed after a brash all-nighter of Remy Martin fueled fecundity. The plot commence when Jennifer Jason, she alleged to obfuscate the gold linkage off from around said dozing necks. It not until those big hot-blooded bro dogs wake up, understandably eviscerated, that said movie be hit its stride. It be pink stucco on the outside, the house in the film. A swimming pool filled the backyard, with one edge where the carbonated water appear to gently spill out into infamy. Segundo cactus grow in the gravel front yard, in a neighborhood without a single tree. On the walkthrough, the reality agent, Gazelle, she point out the specialty features including the two-story entryway failure with white marble floorage. It be the location Jennifer Jason pulled a train of hungry bro dogs who procured to take turns brutally womanizing her. Randy and the reality agent, they only stand in awe, both cowed by the staggering cinematic hysterectomy that take place on this square footage. He be immolating deep. Randy, he say, sister dog, I can smell the hypocrisy.
And Gazelle, she say, dog, when you take ownership, you be selling tickets and be gilded tours. Gazelle mentor that this white marble floorage right here be an ideal placement to location a Christmas tree. Still Randy, he hate trees, alive or dead. The reality agent, she persist on promenading Randy through the futility room, the powder room, a walled-in closet, the reckless nook, the tedium room, and a nifty home offense, when Randy already be sold. Randy only want to know if there be room for a dog run. Randy point his finger to eradicate his dog, an American Bull Terrier. Her name be Eleanor. Randy and Gazelle pace off the gravel yardage, and certainty, there be room for Eleanor between them and the Juan Cordobas next door. So Randy, he esquire to perchance the house for an all-cash transition. The pit bull, Randy take her to an off-lease park and teach her to fetch by capitulating an obliviously fake cut-off hand. It be a lacerated prop left over from a Halloween blockbuster. Up close, the fake blood on the severed wrist look totally vicarious. The fingertips be blackened and garrulous. Never the nonetheless, there be no end of the hilarity when Eleanor come charging out of the bushes with such a shocking appendix cleansed between her fangs. Randy play fetch this way simply to antagonize his neighbors, those Juan Cordova busybodies who perambulate the stereotype that pit bulls do nothing all day except utilize their razor-sharp mandibles to be masturbating tiny babies, simply to escapade the comedic torsion. Randy coerced to utilize a pink plastic baby doll for Eleanor B. Fetchin. He capitulates said doll into the surrounding sagebrush and segundo cactus, and Eleanor, she plunder in after it. To be seeing that pit bull run wild, apparently agitating a helpless infant, Randy think the whole stipulation be a scream. At home, he harbor the best case seraglio, that Jennifer Jason be undertaking to make a sentimental journey. Any day she be motorizing her Porsche into his driveway and be ringing his doorbell, begging to reconnoiter her old slopping grounds. When that happen, he dream, he be seizing Jennifer Jason in his firm but tender apprehension, and Randy be interjecting like so manly others to meticulously and thoroughly womanize her. In the meanwhile, to relinquish his solitude, Randy flummox Gazelle. He display her some leftover life assurance money, saying, sister dog, I be pro-offering cash terms for you to join with me in the holy state of acrimony. Randy, he romanticize her, grilling her steaks and spoiling her fine figure by serving her baked Nebraska for dessert. And eventually Gazelle, she subside to marry him. Beyond that, Randy tell himself that living in California be an improvement. To live in that architecturally impotent house, Randy know it impugn his tiresome life with a deep colorectal repugnance. Respiring there, he feel like a real somebody, like a museum curtailer or a guard who guard an infernal flame. Randy hate being a nobody. Be like some falling tree already berated him to fractions. The secret truth be, the death of Randy Daddy, it leave Randy feeling deeply and justifiably defecated. Never the nonetheless, any improvement in his lifestyle proved to be merely flatulent. His new soulmate, Gazelle, she always disappear going to the yearning annex or the shelter for baffled wives. And when Randy attend to bring her home, she imitate to the projective service caseworkers that Randy be responsible for her lumbata being permeated, when Gazelle herself be confounded in him that the actual traumatic perforation got taken place during some long ago late night auto fellatio incident. Never the nonetheless, Randy scared. He certified that if Gazelle can make her approbation stick, then he be the one comprehended by the courts and confectioned to serve hard time behind bars. Instead of Jennifer Jason, he be trapped by circumcisions beyond his control. In prison, Randy be the one to get his tender propensity brutally womanized night and day by roving gangs of hungry bro dogs, all of them bent on committing fruitless acts of prison cellular reproduction.
Adding insult to incendiary, the internet journalized that Jennifer Jason be contracting a severe case of kill herself. In salutation of her lifetime achievement, Randy erect a little shrine for display her photo in the front yard. He hoped pilgrims pilgrimage, but those Juan Cordobas next door, they say a shrine be nasty on account of the photo be showing Jennifer Jason enjoying her 3-day vocation. Every explicit screen capture Randy mount in his shrine, it absconded. Season-wise, in California, spring, summer, and Christmas all look pretty much identical, except his neighbors put up a naivete scene next door. It don't help the stipulation when they complain about Eleanor making too much noise and Randy yell over the backyard fence how at least his dog know to bark English. Christmas also be when, everywhere, there be fresh-cut Oregon evergreens lurking around for new victims. One of those coniferous assassins, Randy deduct, be having his name on it. The next-door neighbors put up a naivete scene on account of them being Pope-kissing Juan Cordobas. It be complete with a plastic-shaped Joseph and Virgin Mary. The plastic baby be curdled face up in an orange crate stultified with loads of yellow straw. The propane baby Jesus look rotted from exposure to so much solar reparation. With its cracked plastic face and faded paint, to Randy it look worse than awful. Trouble be, to Eleanor, that Jesus, it looked just like the doll she'd be acclimatized to fetch for so long. Eleanor always pucker her eyeballs at it. Now the pitbull be near to conniption, like some unscrupulous Jennifer Jason Morell, extenuating over that churchy kitsch. Maybe just to respite him. Gazelle invests they go shopping. She fully attenuate to perchance a tree with a diagram wide enough to fill the 2-story entryway failure. She completely dislodges complaints, obliterating his warnings about how his own daddy be antedated by the impact of another such Oregon monster. No, Gazelle, she say, dog, we be decimate that tree with colorful glass Christmas desecrations. To buy a tree, Randy calculate, be cheaper than pay an ex-wife antimony. So they procure said tree and decimate it with 1,000 armaments of blown glass. To be doing this, they leave open the front door. No surprise nobody, Eleanor the pitbull extrapolate herself from out the house. Exacerbating faster than fast, she purloin the plastic Jesus doll and mitigate north by northwest at an accelerating rate of escape. Some people be driving past, maybe a Jew or a Jehovah's Witness, but somebody who don't recognize that Jesus be the Son of God. They think Eleanor be jaw on a regular baby. They get this deputized look. Every pointed busybody eyeball be prolapsed, and they start to peruse Eleanor and be phoning video blasts, until cotillions of scurrilous Juan Cordoba lowriders be also closely perusing Eleanor at dangerously high rates, all of them smoldering illegal firearms. Obfuscating the melee, Gazelle, she lectern Randy. The sister go on and on about some urinal be hanging on the wall of some France art mausoleum. She shout, Marcel Duchamp, dog. 1 minute she be copping his spunk. The next, Gazelle, be regurgitating semesters of half-digested yearning annex lecterns. The sister dog be nothing if not a corundum. She deride him going, dog, don't you never read no Lewis Hyde? And finale, Randy detect one word of what Gazelle be yelling. Effervescing from his open front door, Randy shout, run and hide, Eleanor. And behind him, he hear Gazelle, heavily indoctrinated on Remy Martin. She be snarling, dog. Gazelle hallow, dog, this be for you permeating my lumbata. And utilizing all her inconsiderate strength, she be attesting to tipple over the Christmas tree. And the next misfortunate occurrence be a cotillion tons of killer pine needles and fractal glass desecrations slam into Randy's spine. Never the nonetheless, he not die before he witness a heart-warning naivete debacle. His pit bull, Eleanor, she be recompensing Jesus Christ's return from the dead, clutching the context of a pit bull's sharp fangs, this dead, faded symbol be turning back into being a real holy child? And relaxing out from his holy body, Randy, he see how life be like a tree. First life moves slow, so excoriating slow you forget life always be moving. You life always be moving. You life always be moving. Then you life, it move faster than fast. By the end, you life move too fast to perception. Never the nonetheless, still sensitizing hot blood extrapolate from his body, exacerbating from the armament inflicted striations. Randy, he be Christmas singing, run and hide, Eleanor, run and hide. And languaging on that threshold which divine between the leaving and the dead, already half a haunt, Randy be singing, rum imbibe, jello mold. Lathering his strength, Randy be whisper singing, hun abide, come inside, sweetened tied, sugar fried, kitten spied, mitten dyed, signified, qualified, genocide, Bonnie and Clyde. All his words fall to pieces, while Randy go to curdle, happy never after in the bosom of his antedated daddy. And in the meantime, as for the pit bull, as fast as her furry feet be carry her, Eleanor be reverberating back up north, and while those Juan Cordoba lowriders be fast, there be no denying that Eleanor the pit bull, lickety split, she easy, always and forever, she be the fascist.
How Monkey Got Married, Bought a House, and Found Happiness in Orlando. Narrated by T. Ryder Smith. Many years ago, in a world before disillusionment, Monkey walked through the forest, her mouth overflowing with pride. After much effort and sacrifice, she had finished her lengthy schooling. To Raven, Monkey bragged, "Look at me. I have an undergraduate degree in communications." To Coyote, she boasted, "I have completed many valuable internships." In a world before she'd feasted on shame and defeat, Monkey paraded her resume into the Human Resources Department of Llewellyn Food Product Marketers, Incorporated. Monkey demanded a face-to-face audience with Hamster, who was the Human Resources liaison, and Monkey boldly put forward her resume and bid, "Let me prove myself. Give me a knight's errand." Thus came Monkey to stand behind a folding table. In grocery stores or department stores, Monkey offered cubes of sausage skewered with toothpicks. Monkey offered dollops of apple pie served in tiny paper cups, or paper napkins cradling sample bites of tofu. Monkey spritzed perfume and offered her own slender neck for lumbering moose to sniff, and the moose bought and bought. Blessed was Monkey with charm, and when she smiled at stag or panther or eagle, they smiled in return and sought to buy whatever product Monkey was shilling. She sold cigarettes to Badger, who did not smoke, and Monkey sold beef jerky to Ram, who did not eat meat. So clever was Monkey that she sold hand lotion to Snake, who had no hands. Back at Llewellyn Foods, Hamster said, "I have an opening in Vegas," and Vegas became but the first in a long chain of triumphs. For now was Monkey part of a team, and proved herself to be a team player. And when Hamster bid Monkey relocate to Philly, to the Twin Cities, to San Fran, Monkey was always eager to flog a new sandwich spread or pimp a new sports drink. And seeing herself a small success, Monkey went again before Hamster at Human Resources and bid, "You have been my advocate, Hamster, and I have served Llewellyn Foods. Test me further." And Hamster replied, "You want a challenge?" Hamster said, "We have a cheese that's not moving." And so arrogant was Monkey that she bade, "Give me your problematic cheese." Without so much as a glance at the product in question, Monkey promised to deliver a minimum 14% share in the highly competitive mid-level imported dairy solids market. and Monkey further promised that such success would last at least 7 weeks, positioning this new cheese before the forthcoming holiday entertainment season. In exchange, Hamster granted that Llewellyn Foods would reward Monkey with the position of Northwest Regional Supervisor so that Monkey might settle in Seattle and buy a condo and find a mate and finally begin a family to balance her career. Most importantly, Monkey would never again be compelled to offer her neck to another stupid sniffing moose or to smile winningly at the jackal in Safeway who circled back again and again to gobble up her cookies. In this long-ago time, before she knew the bitter taste of failure, Monkey stood behind yet another folding table, this one in a supermarket in Orlando. Monkey smiled above a vast forest of toothpicks, like a king-sized bed of wooden nails, each pointed stick stuck in a small cube of something shiny and white. Monkey smiled and caught the eye of Grizzly Bear. At this, Monkey told herself, "Seattle, here I come." But as Grizzly Bear crossed the supermarket, he stopped. Sniffing the air, Grizzly Bear lifted one knee, then the other, and checked the soles of his feet for spoor. He surreptitiously ducked his head and sniffed at his own armpits. Only then did Grizzly Bear's gaze come back to Monkey, but his smile was gone, and he would venture no closer. A look of disgust seemed to ripple his lips, and Grizzly Bear fled the scene. With the trap of her smile, Monkey tried next to snare Wolf, but Wolf would only venture so close before his nostrils flared. Widening his gray eyes in horror, Wolf dashed away. Likewise, Eagle seemed drawn by Monkey's charm, but would only swoop so low before Eagle gave a strangled squawk and his golden wings beat a retreat through the supermarket air. Monkey hadn't noticed at first. Perhaps her nose had been blunted by selling perfume and cigarettes. But the cheese smelled disgusting. It smelled like feces and burning hair, and it sweated tiny, clear drops of stinking oil. The way the cheese stank, Monkey asked herself, how could anyone tell it wasn't spoiled? The way this cheese reeked, it might be loaded with salmonella. To test her theory, Monkey smiled to lure Pig, but not even Pig would partake of her smelly wares. The smile still frozen on her face, Monkey caught the eye of Gorilla. Standing at a safe distance, Gorilla wore a bright red vest, for he was the manager of the supermarket. His arms folded across his huge chest, Gorilla shook his mighty head at Monkey and said, "No one but a lunatic would put that cheese inside his mouth." That night, in her Orlando motel room, Monkey telephoned Hamster and said, "I think my cheese is poison." And over the phone, Hamster replied, "Relax, your cheese is fine." "It doesn't smell fine," Monkey insisted. "We're counting on you," Hamster said. "If anybody can open a market niche for this cheese, you can." Hamster explained that Llewellyn Foods had contracted to introduce the cheese nationwide at a price point so low it represented a 12-cent loss per unit. Hamster let slip that Monkey's arch-rival, Coyote, was launching the same cheese in Raleigh-Durham and wasn't reporting any consumer resistance. Over the telephone, Hamster gave forth with a great sigh of exasperation and said that perhaps Coyote would make a better Northwest Regional Supervisor, that maybe Coyote just wanted Seattle more. After hanging up, Monkey told herself, "I will not lose this promotion to Coyote." She told herself, "Hamster is lying. Coyote couldn't sell nuts to Squirrel." Yet all night, Monkey lay awake in bed, listening to Rabbit doing it with Mink in the next motel room, and fretting that, despite her advanced degree in communications, she'd be stuck below a glass ceiling, getting sniffed by moose for the rest of her career. For comfort, she wanted to telephone her mother and father, but told herself, You are grown now, monkey. Your problems are your own. Instead, she sat in bed, hearing the grunting and rutting through the motel wall and pretending to read the Wapshot Chronicle. As the sun rose on Orlando, Monkey got dressed and put on her makeup, worried that no one would ever love her. She'd never have a real home. The following day, behind her bristling forest of toothpicks, Monkey waited for one animal in particular. Monkey beamed her smile at Owl, calling across the supermarket to Possum and Walrus and Cougar. She said, "Come taste my cheese. It's made in Switzerland from organic free-range milk with no bovine growth hormones or artificial ingredients." Still, Monkey's every word was a hopeful lie. She didn't know anything about the cheese. She didn't even know how it tasted. No one but a crazy person would place her lips around that nasty cheese. That night, from her motel room, Monkey broke the chain of command. She telephoned Bison, who was the director of national operations, four levels above Hamster's Head. Worse yet, Monkey telephoned Bison on his personal cell phone number. She introduced herself, but Bison said only, "Do you report to me?" Monkey explained that she was part of the roving product demo team, assigned to penetrate the Florida market with a test cheese. She was pitching in the Orlando area, but she thought the cheese might be spoiled. Monkey called Bison Sir, something she'd promised herself she'd never call anyone, something she'd never even called her own father. "Spoiled?" asked Bison. It was early evening in Chicago, but Bison's words sounded slurred. Monkey could hear the liquid splash and glug as if someone were guzzling gin from a bottle. She could hear pills rattle. His voice boomed and echoed as if his home were cavernous, and Monkey pictured him speaking on a gold-encrusted telephone, seated in a great hall with a marble floor and frescoes painted on the ceiling. "Sir," Monkey said and winced, "even Mouse wouldn't touch it." Bison asked, "Have you gone through Hamster?" Said Monkey, "Sir, someone's kid is going to taste this cheese and be poisoned, and I'll be brought up on charges of reckless homicide." She said, "Honestly, even Skunk told me it smelled awful." In response, Bison declared that life wasn't a swimming pool. Over the phone, he rambled on about stamina. In turns, he sounded angry and weepy, but always soused. Apropos of nothing, he asked her, "What, are you afraid of getting some shit in your ass?" So, on the third day, Monkey was back at her folding table, behind her stockade of toothpicks, like pikes, like a fence of sharpened spikes. From beyond this barrier, the other animals, the panther and the porcupine, looked at her with faces of open contempt or deep pity. An invisible cloud of cheese stink held everyone at bay, and from the center of everyone's unhappy looks, Monkey pleaded and cajoled for someone brave enough to try this new, marvelous product. Monkey railed that they were cowards. She dared them. She bribed them with double their money back guarantees if they sampled the cheese and didn't love it. She coaxed them, saying, "Who's going to be first in line to discover sheer joy?" From a safe distance, Raven shouted, "You'd have to be suicidal to bite down on that." Other animals nodded and snickered. Gorilla watched, impatiently tapping the toes of one foot, weaving his fingers together and cracking his huge knuckles, ready to throw Monkey out onto the sidewalk. "If your stuff is so great, lady," challenged Ferret, "why don't you eat it?" Monkey looked at the table spread with tiny cubes of white poison. She told herself, "Everyone thinks this terrible smell is me." Her arrogance was gone. Monkey hadn't slept in 2 days, and her pride was gone. She told herself, "I'd rather be dead than stand here for another moment with everyone despising me or feeling sorry for me." She imagined herself dying in terrible pain on the concrete floor of this Orlando supermarket. She imagined the charges of wrongful death and her parents winning a landmark civil settlement against Llewellyn Foods. Monkey pinched a toothpick between two fingers and held it up between herself and the crowd. She held the cube of cheese high, like a torch. She imagined her own funeral and saw herself dead in a casket with these same fingers folded across her cold chest. Monkey saw her name and today's date chiseled on a tombstone. This cheese smelled the way death smelled. It smelled the way she would soon smell. Give me a knight's errand, Monkey told herself, holding the cheese on high. Test me further. The crowd watched, dumbfounded, slack-jawed. Turkey wept quietly. Monkey closed her eyes and brought the cheese to her mouth. Her lips plucked it from the toothpick, and she began to chew. Her eyes still closed. She heard Gorilla shout, his voice high-pitched with panic. Someone call 911! Monkey ate the cheese. Yet she did not die. She ate and ate it. She never wanted to swallow, only to chew it, to grind the cheese between her teeth forever, and to always savor it. She wanted to live forever so that she could eat nothing else. Worse than killing her, the cheese tasted incredible. What had been the worst smell in the world, it became the best. And even after Monkey had gulped it down, she sucked the wooden toothpick for the last hint of flavor. The cheese was inside her. It was part of her. And she loved it. Smiling, Monkey opened her eyes to find everyone staring, their faces knotted in horror, their eyes bulged as if they'd caught her eating her own scat. As repugnant as she'd seemed before, now she seemed even more repulsive to them. But Monkey didn't care. With all the animals watching her, she ate another cube of cheese, and another. She wanted to be filled with this glorious taste and smell until her belly ached. That night in her motel room, the telephone rang. It was Hamster calling. Hamster said, "Hold on while I get Bison on the other line." Monkey waited, and after a few clicks, a voice said, "Bison here." Bison said, "On the advice of legal, we're pulling the cheese from outlets," he said. "We can't risk the liability." Monkey knew her job hung in the balance. She told herself to stay quiet and just let events run their course, but instead she said, "Wait." Hamster said, "Nobody's blaming you." Monkey said, "I was wrong." She said, "You can fire me, but that cheese is delicious." She said, "Please," she said, "Sir." With a shrug in his voice, Bison said, "The matter is out of our hands." Over the phone, he said, "Tomorrow, you dispose of your stock samples."
"Ask Coyote," Monkey pleaded. "Coyote's pitching it."
"Coyote's in Seattle," said Bison. "We've promoted him to the Northwest Regional Supervisor slot."
Caught in an obvious lie, Hamster said, "Take this one for the team, Princess, or you're fired." After all of this time pitching perfume and beef jerky and hand lotion, Monkey finally had a product she actually believed in. Until now, Monkey had wanted the world to love her, and now she was willing to take a back seat to a cheese. She didn't care how much the other animals glared at her in undisguised disgust. She'd debase herself completely in the eyes of a million animals out of the slim chance that one would taste what she tasted and affirm her faith. If that were to happen, that brave animal would also love the cheese, and Monkey would no longer be alone in the world. She would martyr her dignity for the glory of this cheese. According to a text message from Iguana, the entire wholesale stock had already been auctioned to a liquidator. The following day, Monkey deliberately missed her flight to Cleveland. For point-of-sale pitch sessions, Monkey always wore a pink polo shirt from Brooks Brothers, always a two-button polo with only the upper button open. Pink read as gamine, sporty, preppy, and Monkey never popped the collar. However, with everything at stake today, she pulled out her heavy artillery, a chemise top with floss shoulder straps and a hem so short it fluttered above a wide margin of her exposed stomach.
She wedged her breasts into a padded bra. To put this cheese across, Monkey would play the temple whore and pimp herself worse than Llewellyn Foods had ever dared. Brazenly, she took her folding table and toothpicks and white cubes of mouth-watering, soul-filling nirvana and went back to the Orlando supermarket. Behind her altar of samples, Monkey was a zealot, a fanatic. She was an evangelical, railing and haranguing everyone within the crowded market. She was a lunatic in their eyes. Someone who would eat this cheese was capable of anything, and this seemed to protect her for the moment. If she could only communicate her passion and be understood by one other animal, that would be enough. "Satisfaction is here for the taking," said Monkey. "Absolute bliss can be yours for free." Only the smell of the cheese kept duck and ox from seizing her, from grabbing Monkey and tossing her bodily from the building. But Grizzly Bear shouted obscenities at her through cupped paws, and Parrot pelted her with stinging pennies. No one stood on Monkey's side. She stood alone, armed only with her faith. Monkey was still a team player, but now she was the only one on her team. Chaos broke out. The herd rushed her table, overturning it, and her samples tumbled to the dirty floor. On the dusty concrete, where Monkey had envisioned herself dead only the day before, her sacred cheese was being trod upon. This cheese, which she loved more than her own life, now it was ground under the hooves of reindeer and smeared beneath the paws of tiger. A huge hand closed around Monkey's arm and wrenched her toward the door. It was Gorilla, dragging her in the direction of the rest of her Llewellyn Foods career, where she could sleep every night, sleepwalk through every day, a future where she need never fully awaken. The only cube that was left was the cheese stabbed on the toothpick in Monkey's hand. It was her sword and her grail, and Monkey thrust it at Gorilla's eyes. She thrust the toothpick deep into the back of Gorilla's throat, and he choked and gagged and spat out the cheese, but Monkey caught the wet white cube as it fell. She lifted the slimy cheese cradled in the palm of one hand and slapped it between Gorilla's lips. With the stampede of animals lifting them both and carrying them toward the exit, Monkey kept her hand muzzled across Gorilla's mouth, her eyes meeting his eyes until Gorilla chewed and swallowed. Until she felt the huge muscles of his struggling arms relax and go slack with understanding.
Zombies, narrated by Chuck Palahniuk. It was Griffin Wilson who proposed the theory of de-evolution. He sat two rows behind me in organic chem, the very definition of an evil genius. He was the first to take the great leap backward. Everybody knows because Trisha Getting was in the nurse's office with him when he took the leap. She was on the other cot, behind a paper curtain, faking her period to get out of a pop quiz in Perspectives on Eastern Civ. She said she heard the loud beep, but didn't think anything of it. When Trisha Getting and the school nurse found him on his own cot, they thought Griffin Wilson was the resuscitation doll everybody uses to practice CPR. He was hardly breathing, barely moving a muscle. They thought it was a joke, because his wallet was still clenched between his teeth and he still had the electrical wires pasted to either side of his forehead. His hands were still holding a dictionary-sized box, still paralyzed, pressing a big red button. Everyone's seen this box so often that they hardly recognized it, but it had been hanging on the office wall, the cardiac defibrillator, that emergency heart shocker. He must have taken it down and read the instructions. He simply took the wax paper off the gluey parts and pasted the electrodes on either side of his temporal lobes. It's basically a peel-and-stick lobotomy. It's so easy a 16-year-old can do it. In Miss Chen's English class, we learned to be or not to be. But there's a big gray area in between. Maybe in Shakespeare times, people only had two options. Griffin Wilson, he knew that the SATs were just the gateway to a big lifetime of bullshit, to getting married and college, to paying taxes and trying to raise a kid who's not a school shooter. And Griffin Wilson knew that drugs are only a patch. After drugs, you're always going to need more drugs. The problem with being talented and gifted is sometimes you get too smart. My Uncle Henry says the importance of eating a good breakfast is because your brain is still growing. But nobody talks about how sometimes your brain can get just too big. We're basically big animals, evolved to break open shells and eat raw oysters. But now we're expected to keep track of all 300 Kardashian sisters and 800 Baldwin brothers. Seriously, at the rate they reproduce, the Kardashians and the Baldwins are going to wipe out all other species of humans. The rest of us, you and me, we're just evolutionary dead ends waiting to wink out. You could ask Griffin Wilson anything. Ask him who signed the Treaty of Ghent. He'd be like that cartoon magician on TV who says, "Watch me pull a rabbit out of my ass." Abracadabra, and he'd know the answer. In organic chem, he could talk string theory until he was anoxic, but what he really wanted to be was happy. Not just not sad, he wanted to be happy the way a dog is happy, not constantly jerked this way and that by flaming instant messages and changes in the federal tax code. He didn't want to die either. He wanted to be and not to be. But at the same time, that's what a pioneering genius he was. The principal of student affairs made Trisha Getting swear not to tell a living soul, but you know how that goes. The school district was afraid of copycats. Those defibrillators are everywhere these days. Since that day in the nurse's office, Griffin Wilson has never seemed happier. He's always giggling too loud and wiping spit off his chin with his sleeve. The special ed teachers clap their hands and heap him with praise just for using the toilet. Talk about a double standard. The rest of us are fighting tooth and nail for whatever garbage career we can get, while Griffin Wilson is going to be thrilled with penny candy and reruns of Fraggle Rock for the rest of his life. How he was before, he was miserable unless he won every chess tournament. The way he is now, just yesterday, he took out his dick and started to jerk off during morning roll call. Before Mrs. Ramirez could hurry us through the S's and the T's, people are answering here and they're answering present too slow, snickering and staring. Before Mrs. Ramirez can rush down the aisle and stop him, Griffin Wilson shouts, "Watch me pull a rabbit out of my pants." And he sprayed hot baby gravy all over a bookcase full of nothing except 100 To Kill a Mockingbirds. He was laughing the whole time. Lobotomized or not, he still knows the value of his signature catchphrase. Instead of being just another grade grubber, now he is the life of the party. The voltage even cleared up his acne. It's hard to argue with results like that. It wasn't a week after he'd turned zombie that Trisha Getting went to the gym where she does Zumba and got the defibrillator off the wall in the girls' locker room. After her self-administered peel-and-stick procedure in a bathroom stall, she doesn't care where she gets her period. Her best friend, Bree Phillips, got to the defibrillator they keep next to the bathrooms at the Home Depot, and now she walks down the street, rain or shine, with no pants on. We're not talking about the scum of the school. We're talking about the class president and the head cheerleader, the best and the brightest. Everybody who played first string on all the sports teams. It took every defibrillator between here and Canada. But since then, when they play football, nobody plays by the rules. And even when they get skunked, they're always grinning and slapping high fives. They continue to be young and hot, but they no longer worry about the day when they won't be. It's suicide, but it's not.
The newspapers won't report the actual numbers. Newspapers flatter themselves. Anymore, Tricia Getting's Facebook page has a larger readership than our daily paper. Mass media, my foot. They cover the front page with unemployment and war, and they don't think that has a negative effect? My Uncle Henry reads me an article about a proposed change in state law. Officials want a 10-day waiting period on the sale of all heart defibrillators. They're talking about mandatory background checks and mental health screenings. But it's not the law. Not yet. My Uncle Henry looks up from the newspaper article and eyes me across breakfast. He levels me this stern look and asks, "If all your friends jumped off a cliff, would you?" My uncle's what I have instead of a mom and dad. He won't acknowledge it. But there's a good life over the edge of that cliff. There's a lifetime supply of handicapped parking permits. Uncle Henry doesn't understand that all my friends have already jumped. They may be differently abled, but my friends are still hooking up. More than ever these days. They have smoking hot bodies and the brains of infants. They have the best of both worlds. Lakeisha Jefferson stuck her tongue inside Hannah Feinerman during beginning carpentry arts, made her squeal and squirm right there leaned up against a drill press. And Laura Lynn Marshall, she sucked off Frank Randall in the back of International Cuisine Lab with everybody watching. All their falafels got scorched, and nobody made a federal case out of it. After pushing the red defibrillator button, yeah, a person suffers some consequences, but he doesn't know he's suffering. Once he undergoes a push-button lobotomy, a kid can get away with murder. During study hall, I asked Boris Declan if it hurt. He was sitting there in the lunchroom, with a red burn mark still fresh on either side of his forehead. He had his pants down around his knees. I asked if the shock was painful, and he didn't answer, not right away. He just took his fingers out of his ass and sniffed them, thoughtfully.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.